everyone. Today I will be presenting to you all on the impact of disability representation on disability stigma in a general population. I'll first start with a brief overview of disability. So about 27% of adults in the United States live with some form of disability, and this can range from having a learning disability like dyslexia or a spinal cord injury. And discrimination against individuals with disabilities is known as ableism, which is a social process of oppression and bias. While disability is traditionally defined in a medical sense, in that people often look at a disabled individual and view them and their body as in need of fixing or a cure, it can also be defined as a social construction. And this is a more progressive view of disability because it places the onus on society to do their part in making the world more accessible and inclusive. Moving on to disability and stigma. So the definition of stigma is the recognition and labeling of differences between people that are associated with negative stereotypes. And individuals view people with disabilities through a stereotypical lens, which often comes from this social construction of normie identities. That is the driving force behind disability stigma. So the normie identities that we've socially constructed often include the majority groups. So for example, that would be maybe white people, men, and non-disabled individuals. And then the minority groups are not viewed in this normie identity group that we have socially constructed. So this leads to stigmatization of individuals in those groups. There are many consequences of disability stigma. So negative perceptions of disabled individuals have consequences for the individual themselves, but also society at large. So for example, if we do not all do our part to make the world more accessible and inclusive, then if we live long enough, we'll inevitably become disabled either temporarily or permanently. And then we are doing ourselves a disservice by not making the world more accessible and inclusive. So stigma results in a consequence for society in that way. And then with the notion of social identity theory, which states that individuals who are members of minority groups can preserve their psychological well-being if they are able to claim that identity. This can have negative consequences as relates to stigma, because if a disabled individual is experiencing stigma due to their disability, they may not claim a disabled identity, and therefore they will not identify with their group, and they'll experience decreased psychological well-being. Microaggressions are also a really great consequence of disability stigma, and they're subtle, often unintentional forms of discrimination that occur in everyday life. And they're just an everyday reminder of the stigmatization of disability, which can be really damaging. So how does stigma connect to representation? So the way that disability is represented affects different people's attitudes towards disabled individuals. And media representations of people with disabilities are often stereotypical. So they'll often emphasize stereotypes that have to do with the disabled person maybe being a villain or being magical or an inspiration, and various other stereotypes. And one example of a stereotype that's really prominent is this so-called super crip narrative, which is in line with the inspiration narrative. And this is the portrayal of people with disabilities as like ultra accomplished, simply basically for just living their lives as disabled people. And this is harmful because it sends the message that disability is an inherently negative experience, which it is not. So one of the studies that I looked at was the Coleman study. And this study examined the impact of positive representations of people with disabilities on disability stigma in a population of college students. So for their procedure, they had two different groups that college students were randomized in. They had the experimental group and the control group. The participants in the experimental group first viewed a video that featured various different disabled people in a positive manner, and it was called I Am Abled. And then the participants took the disability IAT, and then they took the attitudes toward disability scale and the the Disability Communication Apprehension Scale, whereas those in the control group took the disability IAT and then viewed the video and took the measures. And surprisingly, they did not find a difference in implicit bias about disability between the two groups. So to that end, there are some gaps in the literature that I reviewed. There have not been any studies that have examined counter-stereotypical or stereotypical disability representation through vignettes, and these studies have also not used a general population. For my study, my main aim was to examine the potential differences in the impact of counter-stereotypical and stereotypical disability representation on disability stigma in a general population. So I had two main hypotheses. My first hypothesis was that there would be a significant interaction between group and time, such that individuals in the counter-stereotypical condition would have decreased disability stigma at post-exposure and would also have lower disability stigma than the stereotypical group and the control group at post-exposure. And then my other hypothesis was that individuals in the stereotypical group would have increased disability stigma at post-exposure and would have increased disability stigma compared to the counter-stereotypical group and the control group at post-exposure. Participants of my study consisted of 246 people from a general population, and I conducted a G-power analysis that said I would need 189 participants necessary for sufficient power, so I had plenty of participants for my analyses. And my inclusion criteria included being at least 18 years old and literate in English, and I also had 28 participants who identified as disabled. So this survey was administered via Qualtrics, and participants were recruited via Amazon Cloud Research Connect, and they were compensated $4 for their time, which is the equivalent to $12 an hour since the survey took approximately 20 minutes to complete. And I received these funds through the Abernathy grant. The procedure of my study involved participants first completing visual analog scales that assessed their current attitudes towards people with disabilities. And then they were randomized into one of three groups, either the counter-stereotypical representation group, the stereotypical representation group, or the no disability representation group, which was the control group. And in these groups, they each read four vignettes depicting either a person with a disability in a counter-stereotypical way, a stereotypical way, or just an individual succeeding in life with no disability mentioned. After reading the vignettes, they then completed the same visual analog scales again, assessing their current attitudes about disabled individuals. They also completed the attitudes toward disability scale and the disability communication apprehension scale. Then I asked participants about their disability experience, so if they identified as a disabled individual. If they said yes, they then completed the disability microaggression scale. And then all participants completed questionnaires on disability representation and demographics. These are some examples of the vignettes. So you can see there's one from counter-stereotypical, stereotypical, and control group. I underlined the parts in the counter-stereotypical and the stereotypical where they differ. The counter-stereotypical vignette is exactly the same as the control, except no disability is mentioned in the control. So these are descriptive statistics of my participants. So I conducted chi-square analyses to ensure there are no baseline differences for gender, race, or ethnicity by group. And I also conducted a between subjects ANOVA to make sure there were no age differences by group at baseline. And I did not find any significant differences. So once again, my main aim was to examine the potential differences and the impact of counter-stereotypical and stereotypical representation on disability stigma in a general population. So this is first looking at disability stigma. So I conducted a 2x3 mixed ANOVA to examine the impact of disability stigma by group and over time. And there was a significant interaction with a pretty large effect size. So you can see that there was that counter-stereotypical And for the counter-stereotypical group, disability stigma decreased over time. And then for the stereotypical group, disability stigma increased over time. And then there was a significant difference between the stereotypical group and the control group, and a significant difference between the counter-stereotypical group and the stereotypical group, but there was not a significant difference between the control group and the counter-stereotypical group. This was looking at positive qualities of the vignettes. So as participants read the vignettes, they answered questions about how they felt about the individual depicted in the vignettes. So I conducted a between subjects ANOVA to look at differences between groups, and I found there was a significant main effect for group for positive qualities with a pretty large effect size as well. And there was a significant difference between the counter-stereotypical group and the stereotypical group, and the stereotypical group and the control group. However, there was no significant difference between the counter-stereotypical group and the control group. Now this is looking at commonality of vignettes. So again, under each vignette, participants were asked how common it would be for them to hear about this type of person. So I conducted a between subjects ANOVA for group for commonality, and there was a significant main effect with kind of a medium effect size. And there was a significant difference between the counter-stereotypical group and the stereotypical group, and the counter-stereotypical group and the control group, but there was no significant difference between the stereotypical group and the control group. Finally, I conducted a between subjects ANOVA to look at negative attitudes about inclusion for groups. So this is the inclusion subscale of attitudes toward disability scale. And there was a significant main effect for group with a large effect size, and there were significant differences between all the groups for negative attitudes about inclusion. For my exploratory results, I looked at disabled versus non-disabled participants to see if there were any differences across all the variables. So I conducted T-tests to do this, and the most telling was that when looking at disability stigma, there were not any differences between disabled and non-disabled participants. So disabled participants still exhibit stigma. For my discussion, I'll just highlight some major points of my discussion. So firstly, my vignettes successfully decreased stigma for the counter-stereotypical group and successfully increased stigma for the stereotypical group. And this is in line with previous research. Lynn and Stutz found that in their study, counter-stereotypical information about individuals of higher weight decreased stigma about those people, and stereotypical information about individuals of higher weight increased stigma about those people. And then also there was a positive versus negative valence for the vignettes. So there was not a significant difference between the control group and the counter-stereotypical group for disability stigma, and this could be due to the positive valence of both the counter-stereotypical and the control vignettes versus the negative valence of the stereotypical vignettes. There are several limitations pertaining to my study. So firstly, with participants, I did not have a very diverse pool. I had mostly white, non-Hispanic men participate in my study, and I also did not have too many disabled participants, so that is limiting. With respect to my procedure, participants possibly could have guessed the purpose of the study through completing the visual analog scales pre and post, and could have possibly responded based on what they thought I wanted to find. And then also with my measures, the attitudes toward disability scale had a lot of items that could have been interpreted differently and in a positive or negative way. So specifically, one example is there was an item that said, people with a disability find it harder to make new friends. And someone who holds stigma towards disabled individuals could respond in the affirmative, thinking, I would not want to be friends with a disabled person. But someone who doesn't hold stigma could respond in the affirmative, thinking that people with disabilities do experience stigma, and this could be a hardship for them. So that's an example of a confusing item. And also all of the items in the gains subscale of the attitudes toward disability scale could have been interpreted in a positive way. So there's some limitations there. There's several implications pertaining to my study, mainly that stories can be used to reduce stigma, so therefore representation matters, and representation can be used as a stigma reduction strategy. So writers and directors of movies, TV shows, books should all take care to firstly include disabled people in their work, but then to also do so in a non-stereotypical manner to reduce those misconceptions and stigma eventually. And then also stigma reduction can be carried out informally through hiring of people with disabilities in prominent roles. So if someone sees a disabled individual as their doctor or their lawyer or their professor, then hopefully that would show them that people with disabilities can be involved in society and are accomplished, and then that would reduce the stigma. Future directions of my study could involve expanding the scope of the vignettes. So my vignettes only focused on one trope, which was the pity dependence trope for disability. So these vignettes could be adjusted to include more tropes in the future. And then also my study should be replicated in more diverse samples, since again, my study did not have very much diversity. Thank you, Dr. Stutz, Dr. Good, and Dr. Salter for being here. Any questions?